Hello. So am I audible to everyone? Okay. So I'll start off with a few questions just to understand the audience a little better. Firstly, how many of you all are aware of what, it's fine, right? Yes, I'm audible to everyone, right? Even the people right at the back. If I'm audible, please raise your hand. Okay. So I'll start off with a few questions just to understand the audience a little better. Firstly, how many of you all are aware of what the term data visualization is? And it doesn't have to be in a lot of detail, but at least at a conceptual level, you all would be quite comfortable with the understanding of the term. Okay. And how many of you all have worked on projects that involved data visualization? So it might have been directly or indirectly that there was participation, but okay. And how many of you all have actually done data visualization design, where you all were given a data set, maybe in a tabular form or an Excel sheet or a database, and you all had to create an interface to make it consumable? Okay. So just to give some context and keep us all on the same page, data visualization, especially the scope in this presentation, I'll be talking about data visualization as every aspect where data has been represented graphically to make it easy to consume. So it involves everything from a simple line chart or a bar graph to something very complex like a network diagram or a sunburst or one of those things. And the thing is, this concept of data visualization is not new. It has been around for a really long time. In fact, given historic findings, we have drawings that depict the movement of the sun and planets and all of those things. And I'll just share a few examples with you where data visualization has been used more on a commercial note. So this is a newspaper clipping from the Montana Standard. This was soon after the fall of 1929, which was an economic crisis. And the newspaper a year later had this line charts. And this is in the year 1930, almost a decade away. And likewise, we got another line chart to the right side, which also depicts some financial metrics. Around 50 years later, there was another economic crisis. This was in the early 1980s. And again, there were line charts used to depict the current scenario. This was in different cities in Canada. A few years later, we had another economic crisis, and this day is known as a Black Monday. In some parts of the world, it would be Black Tuesday, so depending on which part of the world you're from. And this was the front page of the New York Times. And over here again, as you can see, there was a line chart that showed the rise and the sudden drop in the stock market. And while I was making this presentation, I opened a new tab and I went to Wall Street Journal. And over here on the right, if you see, again, there is a line chart that depicts the economic, the stock market of Asia. Now, generally, line charts are used to show trends. It depicts trends, so certain rises, certain falls, etc. And when I looked at these four line charts, I noticed a different kind of trend. So the trend is not economical. It's more on a design front. And if you look at the line charts displayed right in 1930s till all the way in the current times, you see the basic structure hasn't changed at all. You've got an x-axis, you've got a y-axis, and you've got a certain line that depicts the trend. The slope shows whether it's a high or a low or a peak and how steep it is. So this structure hasn't changed, and the reason it hasn't changed is because the basic structure of a line chart has been an all size, it's something that has worked for different sizes and different contexts. So earlier we had situations when the charts had to be drawn by hand. Then we had printing presses. Now we've got screens, and it has worked in all of these contexts and all of these situations. So somewhere, because it hasn't changed over all these years, it is almost hardwired in our mind as a certain structure that this is what a line chart should be. And this is the case not just with the line chart, but with all the different type of charts, the basic ones especially, like the bar chart, the scatter chart, etc. We've got the same perception in mind, and we know that this is what it should be. Yeah. So far it hasn't been a problem. It has worked on all of these situations. But now we are beginning to face a problem is because the screens are becoming smaller. Slowly now we are moving to mobile phones, and now we need to make the same charts work on mobile. And one thing that is noticed is currently, because we are hardwired to look at charts this way and perceive charts this way, we automatically narrow down the scope of what we can do to make them fit on a smaller screen. So the general tendency is we'll look at a line chart and we'll think, okay, how do I show this line chart on a mobile? How do I show this bar chart on a mobile? And other elements on the page, like if you look at a menu bar. So if I showed you all a menu bar and I said that there are five options over here and I want to put this on mobile, I know almost everyone will suggest a hamburger menu, which is something we have a consensus on. Similarly, if you've got a three-column layout and I want to put it on mobile, everyone is going to say, make it a one-column layout for the sake of a mobile. But if I show a chart like this and I say, I want to show this on mobile, we'll have different answers, different suggestions. People will think differently. And that's another challenge, where we do not have best practices or well-established, well-tested principles. So this problem is going to become even bigger. And that is what we've noticed. And so in my team, I'm part of Tata Consultancy Services, and I work in a team called PXCOE, which is Product Experience Center of Excellence. So we've observed two patterns over here, which highlights how big this problem is going to be in the near future. One is there is a drop in user experience. So one of the things that we do as a team in TCS is we rate all the other applications on user experience. We test them on basic parameters like ease of use, speed of use, consistency, learnability, system feedback, etc. And we give a certain score. So if it's good UX, it will be higher score, low UX, lower score. And what we observed is even applications that are designed well in terms of the overall visual aesthetics as well as design principles like responsive design, etc. In the case of a dashboard section or a report section or a section where we've got charts or graphs, over there is a drop in user experience. So users might be comfortable moving through the different pages in the application, but if they have to use a dashboard or a report section, there's a bit of dread where, you know, it might look good, but when it comes to usability, there are certain glitches and certain hiccups over there. The other pattern we've noticed is that there's an increase in demand for data visualization on mobile. And this is in B2B as well as B2C. Now my context is more in B2B, and over there the general ask has been because dashboards and reports are normally accessed by senior people who tend to travel a lot, if there's a constraint of time or any resources, the first ask would be to make at least the reports and dashboard section responsive. And even for B2C section like us, we've slowly moving to mobile for activities like banking, purchasing, etc. So there is a shift. So on one side, we've got an element that's bringing down user experience, and on the other side, we've got demand for that same element increasing with time. So it is quite important for us to at least come up with some best practices, principles, some research, because this is a recurring problem. We would need a solution that we can apply. So that is why we've started research in this area. We've tested different approaches, different concepts, trying to see what are the challenges users face when coming up with mobiles. And currently, we are still in the process of that research. I see at least a year or two more till we are having something extremely concrete. So what I'm going to share now as guidelines, don't think of them as rules that have to be followed for in all situations. They're more like guidelines to guide our thinking. So we ensure that we consider all the different aspects while we design a chart for mobile. So these are the guidelines. So before I get into the first suggestion, this is a Gantt chart. So how many of you are aware of or are familiar with what a Gantt chart is? Okay. So the Gantt chart is normally used to depict the project plans. And what we have on the left side is a list of tasks that are part of the project. And what we have on the right side is certain bars. The bars depict the start and the end, planned start, planned end, and actual start and actual end dates of those tasks. And the color shows which one is planned and which one is actual. So the green ones are the planned and the blue ones are the actuals. And these kind of charts are normally used mostly by project managers, and even other people are involved in the project to see how the overall project is going. Is it on time? Is it delayed? And overall, where am I spending most of my time? Where am I spending less of my time? Now, if we were to show this chart on mobile, we had this situation. We had this chart and we had to show it on mobile. And one thing that we noticed is there are no guidelines. So it was up to the designers. And like I said earlier, we are hardwired to think of a chart in a certain way. So there were many suggestions that came in from the community when we checked online as well as internally during brainstorming. But to summarize the two solutions that came up was, one, we can have a horizontal scroll. So this chart is very horizontal, it's quite broad, but on mobile, we would tend to use it more as in the portrait orientation. So just make it horizontal. Two is maybe have the tasks, the list of tasks occupy around 60% of the screen, and the rest of the 40% would be fixed and the rest would be scrollable. Or third is force the users to use the mobile in landscape mode. Now all of these suggestions clearly are bad UX, and it would be expecting too much of the users to accommodate this expectation. And while we were thinking further, what I noticed is our approach itself is wrong. We are trying to solve the wrong goal. We are thinking, how do I show this Gantt chart on a mobile? But the actual intent is, there is a use case that is served by this Gantt chart. How do I ensure that this use case is served, irrespective of what device is being used? So that would be the first suggestion, that shift of mindset, where we shouldn't look at how do I put this chart on a mobile, but let's think of how do I fulfill this use case on mobile. So now we look at the use case of a Gantt chart. Basically, if a project manager is going to come to the chart, they'll want to know how well is my project doing at this current point of time. What is it on time? Is it delayed? If it is delayed, why is it delayed? And what corrective measures can I take? So there is a way of solving that problem without even the chart itself. where we can just show a list of the tasks, the subtasks, the planned and end dates, and we can have a status. Is it on time? Is it delayed? Has it started, not started, etc. So now this would beg a question of why don't we use this on a desktop? So actually there is a bit of a trade-off, where over here you can textually see that something is delayed by 2 days, while in a Gantt chart you can visually see how much a task is delayed. So there is that slight trade-off where over there you can quickly notice something that is delayed for long, while here you'd have to scan through the text. But clearly this would be better than having horizontal scrolls and forcing people to change orientations, etc. So for the next guideline, now this is another scenario which we often have, is we've got a simple line chart and we've got interactions. So a common interaction with line chart on desktops is we might have a lot of data, like 5 years, 6 years, 7 years of data, and the users would normally hover on certain points on the line chart if they want to have a deeper analysis and look at the points, precise values. If you move this to mobile, there is no equivalent to a hover. Over there we've got tap, swipe, certain gestures, but we do not have a hover over there. So that is one challenge. The other challenge is if we were to use something like a tap or a tap and hold, the user's finger itself would obstruct the very space that he is trying to view. And thirdly, different users would have different finger sizes. So they might end up touching two lines instead of one. They might cover a bigger area, a smaller area, and that's a variation that the designer would have to deal with. Like even they do not know what space would be covered by the user's finger. So that brings me to the second guideline. We normally think of responsive design and mobile as just shrinking of screens. And what we normally do is in the CSS, we would apply some CSS queries, media queries, and ensure that, okay, if it is this resolution, then this is a new size, this is a new layout. But actually, it's not just screen sizes, but also medium of interaction. Where on a desktop, we've got mouse and a keyboard, we've got keyboard shortcuts, and on a desktop, we've got something entirely different, which is swipe, gestures, tapping. So for that, we might have to add or subtract certain elements and make it more user-friendly for a mobile. So in this case, what we've done is we've added a slider below the chart. Now the reason we've added it below the chart is so it does not cover the screen itself. The screen is still completely visible. We can budget enough space in the slider. So whether it's a thick finger or a thin finger, it would cover equal amount of area. We can mitigate that risk. And three is from an ease of use point of view, we've mentioned the values along in the legend. So you don't need to look at the legend, then look at the line, then look back at the legend. Over here itself, you can quickly read the values for the data points. This is a third scenario. Yes. Sorry, I'm not able to hear you. Okay, this. Okay. So this is a third scenario where we've got a bar chart. It's simple bar chart with just about 5 bars. But the labels below are long strings of text, especially the first one and the fourth one. So this again would be a challenge if we were to show this on mobile, where the text would be appearing very close to each other and we might read, visit or social watch videos as one single line because there would be no space to differentiate between the text. So this brings you to the third point, which is you might want to revisit the layout itself. So like I mentioned earlier, we are hardwired to see a bar chart in a certain way. It doesn't have to be that way. You can break these elements and rearrange them in certain ways. So here a solution would be to rearrange the bar chart such that you've got text to use 100% of the screen width, and you've got the bar as well to use 100% of the screen width. So here the text is more legible. You can easily differentiate between the different labels. We've arranged it in descending order. So use cases of most and least is quickly served. And at the same time, you can visually see the difference of how much most and how much least, how much is it exceeding. Yes, here's another scenario where we've got a line chart and we've got just 12 months, January till December. Now generally, again, over here to show 12 labels on a mobile would be a challenge. You would not know how to show all of them. And at the same time, if we had years or some other value, we could add intervals. So we could show every second or every third label and skip the ones in the middle. But if you've got January to December and you plan on showing every second, you would end at November and there would be no place for December if you keep the consistency. Similarly, if you think of showing it at a quarter level and you want to still have monthly data, you might show February and then April, and then again it would not be very consistent. You don't start with Jan and you don't end with December. So here you can visit content. Now content is something that seems very trivial but is often overlooked. And over here again, you've got scope to reduce complexity. So in the case of January, February, March, we can have a situation where on the desktop we would have the whole words. But on a mobile, we might shorten it and just have Jan, Feb, March. And if this was a challenge, we could still have just J, F, M, etc. Likewise, if you got 30,000, 40,000, 50,000, you can have 30K, 40K, 50K. If you got lakhs, you can have L, millions would be M. And likewise, somewhere in the content itself, the way you format your numbers, the way you depict the text, you can still shorten things. And on mobile, every character and every, even a full stop or something makes a difference overall. Here's another scenario. We've got, so data visualization is all about data, and quite often we've got a lot of data. And mobiles have advanced a lot. We've got much more resources. It's quite fast now, but it's still not equivalent to the counterparts of a laptop and a desktop. Another thing is, while we are traveling, we might have intermittent connections. We might have a lower speed of the internet, etc. So those are some additional parameters that we need to think about while we design for mobile, which would be hardware and the network. So while we're showing it on a mobile, it's good to try and restrict the amount of elements and the amount of data we are showing to simply fulfill the use case. So over here, instead of showing the entire bar chart, we shorten it to the top five. If the use case was to see what is the most and make a comparison at that, and to allow the user to drill deeper, we still have the view more option where the user can continue going further down the line. So these were some that we've come across so far. Okay, so we've got time for Q&A as well, if you'll have any questions. Yes.
So I am saying, if suppose you have a grid structure, right, where you are working and there have 15, 20 columns out there, right, and somewhat almost all the columns are necessary. So can you suggest something on that, how to utilize the whole data set into the smaller screens?
Yes, so you're seeing a table, right, with a lot of columns.
Yeah, grid structure, yeah.
Yes, so that we would revisit the use case and the context. So we've had that scenario with us as well, where we had a table with certain columns, but it wasn't many columns, it was around 5 to 6 columns. So over there, what we did is we made it a nested list. So we had the header. So it was more like a list of metadata for each thing. So we had name, so-and-so, age, so-and-so, etc. There was one use case scenario and one issue where the user had to scroll up and down a bit, but that was one challenge that we had, and we could not have the horizontal scroll in all of these elements. But in that particular scenario, this served the purpose. Another thing that we did is we designed for each orientation. So while the user viewed it on portrait mode, they got the list of all the data. So they could quickly see, okay, what is the name, so-and-so, what is his age, so-and-so, etc. But if the user switched it to a landscape, then we showed it in the tabular format. No, so the design is free, we are free to use whatever tool we are comfortable with. It's more of a design approach that we would take. So these, no. Yes. Yes. So if it's a very complex chart, generally D3 is what is used. And frankly, we are free to use whatever library we are comfortable with. That will be even for the design. This was more on the approach, from the design approach. So the examples that I showed were simple PowerPoint charts itself, where I had the elements added.
Yes. Okay. So how about in the case of a network diagram, as if like a mind map? So we use these kind of diagrams in the desktop based. So there could be a scenario where we might end up providing these kind of graphs in the mobile device. So I'm even still worried about this, if this kind of a use case if we come across.
Yes. So in network diagrams, generally the use case is, now the network diagrams that I've seen, they've got a lot of nodes. And generally someone who's not familiar with the use case and all, they think, what do I do with so many nodes? I obviously cannot look at so much data. The general use case with network diagrams is you want to see clusters and patterns. Like if there is a certain area where there are many relations or there are a lot of a cluster of many things, those would be the area generally with a network diagram. If that is a use case, you can rearrange this into, so top of my mind, what I've got is you can have a nested list arranging from the most connections to the least connections, and then you can drill deeper into them. That would be one solution. Yes, but you would have data of the connections. Like you'll have a parent and a child, or you'll have a one-to-many kind of a relationship.
So we can't see
Yes. So that data would have to be processed if we are using one of these solutions. So like I said, this is still an ongoing research. We've not yet reached this chart, but this was something that I had considered in one of our use cases. Yes. So one solution was where we could think of if there's a particular node which has many connections, we can show that right on top. If the use case is to see where you've got a big cluster, it would be the same insight. Another way is if further on the line, what I feel is maybe AI and all might also come in use, where part of the heavy lifting of finding an insight itself would be done by AI. But those are still something for the future, so even I would not want to talk too much on that. But to summarize, it would be use case.
Guys, we can actually extend this talk for another 5-10 minutes. So if you have any questions to ask, you can please ask him.
Hi. Actually, my question is that when you say shrinking a dashboard to a smaller screen, a dashboard might contain many more graphs in one screen. So scrolling a lot to see a lot of graphs or having a marker of the line chart below the line chart and then having another line chart below it, it won't look better, good, I think. So is there any suggestion for having multiple charts in a smaller screen?
Yes, so these suggestions were at a chart level. At a dashboard level where we've got multiple different data, different charts, the approach will be similar to if we had a, let's say a gallery of images. So in that case, we would show them one below the other. We would use a similar approach over here. Or we can have something like a carousel, or we can have tabs showing the different type of charts. So that will be more of outside the data visualization, where at a UI level, we would need to think of something. There, the traditional approach that we would take from a responsive design point of view would come into play. But what I'm thinking is we can have a card inside which you would have all of this interaction. So you can swipe through different cards, either horizontally, vertically, through tabs, an accordion. And inside that, you would have these sliders and all these elements in it. Any other questions?
Can you pass it? Hi. So I want to know, like, example, we have pie charts, right? Because we have to show performance and sort. But how would you tackle it if another sort of data set comes into the play and we have to actually show it with the pie charts as well? I'm trying to figure that one out. Got because it. Line, I guess the bar charts, you know, I understand it is manageable, but what do we do with like pie charts and
okay,
sort
so
of
chart? This is actually out of the, I mean, this is not about responsive design, this would be about data visualization in general. Two things is, one is pie charts are generally considered something that would not be recommended. Because when you've got a pie chart and you've got these angles, they're very tough to compare within the pie as well as if you have different pie charts. And two is, so the process of data visualization, like at a very high level, if I were to summarize this, you look at the use case, you look at the data, the type of data and the dimensions within the data, and then you create a visualization. So if you've got just one two-dimensional data, which would be, let's say, the name of a person and his score or his age, or something that would come into a pie chart, this example would actually not come into a pie chart, then that would be appropriate for a pie chart. But if you've got a third dimension, then that data itself will be in a different chart. So that, depending on the type of data, is it quantitative or qualitative, we would have certain charts that might work. Like if it is quantitative, a scatter chart or a bubble chart might accommodate more dimensions. And if it is something entirely different, you would have to create something custom altogether.
Thank you.
Any other questions? One at the end. Okay, this one.
Okay. How do you deal with images? Images.
Sorry?
How do you deal with images? Suppose we have put a banner image or something, and then in the responsive mode, it is not readable.
I didn't get you. Image?
Image. How do we deal fitting the image?
Actually, image would be a completely separate thing. It would not be a data visualization. So.
No, not about the data visualization. If it is if it's a very huge image, it is a single image, how do we like represent it?
That would actually be out of data visualization. So it would be responsive design.
Okay.
Where you would basically have different images and load them.
If you cannot cut the image.
A smaller file size basically for a mobile.